tips and life stories about how to live a healthy life and have a career and have that balance.
I'm not sure how many of mine are tips, but I can know a lot of tricks.
Hey, well, I think that still counts for sure.
I'm still alive.
Hey, that's a success in itself.
I feel great. That means I have a chance to find another day.
Exactly. No joke, right? So,
you had to work toward it. You worked toward all this.
Very true. And I think that's the next thing I wanted to cover and kind of elaborate on is our expectations that we set of ourselves and also the expectations that we allow other people to place on us.
That's a big weakness for me.
So would you elaborate on yours, and I'll elaborate one on mine, like one weakness that you faced growing up, maybe in your career, of an expectation people had of you?
Let's see, an expectation in my career. Well, first of all, I think my biggest expectation from others was that I was going to be a woman. And I went out and dug the ditches and worked on the truck scales and poured the concrete and did the programming and worked in the feed yards and worked in the chemical plants. And it took a couple of years, but when I would get that call that said I want to talk to the man in charge and explain to them that that would be me, a couple of years after that they started asking for that woman. And so those expectations of a man being in charge, I overcame that and let them quit seeing it as a sexist point of view and a doer point of view, the woman who made it happen.
Exactly. And I think an expectation that I struggle with, and I think I still struggle with right now, is the expectation of me being really young and in a marriage and having this expectation to start a family. And it's like,
okay. She does not get that from me.
No. And it's like, and I have no like harsh feelings about that, but I feel like we need to define we need to realize that your expectation is your perspective onto me. And also we need to realize that as people receiving that expectation, is that they're seeing their lens of us onto us and that expectation. It used to really hack me off when people asked me when I was going to have kids. I mean, it would really, really peeve me off.
Really?
Yeah. Because I'm like, am I only here to bear children? I would like to be able to have a career. I want to have an impact in the world. I feel like it's, don't get me wrong, I think family is so important. It's one of the greatest things I've had. But I feel like for me, at least at this point in my life, I feel like my place is to make an impact in a different way rather than have an impact in a family.
Well, I was 33 when I had
kids. Yeah, exactly.
So I know what you mean about saying when you're going to have children.
Yeah, exactly.
When she was ready to get here, that's when I had her.
Exactly. So I think it's important to realize that you also don't have to set yourself to those expectations.
Correct.
And also you need to realize that sometimes people are just saying that because that's what's common and they're not doing you
that's
any
due well justice.
And not doing you any due justice. It's just what's common that people do, and there's nothing wrong with what's common because that's a lot of people's dreams. But we need to realize that through a lens of empathy, that that's what they're doing as well. And I think that kind of feeds into that not one size fits all in a lot of things, especially in a healthy life. So for example, I have never been a big proponent of eliminating any food groups or anything of that sort, or really kind of extremist diets. And so, but
I am though.
But, and that's also her, but also we need to realize that what works for somebody differs from each person. So really you need to take something from each diet or lifestyle, apply it to you the best of what works, because what works for her actually would not work for me, and she's my mother. She lives a ketogenic lifestyle right now, and it works brilliantly for you at this point. And I do a moderate ketogenic, but I have a higher carb source, but my activity level is very different.
Activity is much higher than mine.
Yeah, so I think if I was a little more sedentary, I think I would probably be higher on the ketogenic diet, which is a high-fat diet for those of you who are not aware of what that is.
Anti-inflammatory as well, which is great for pain reduction.
Yes. And also, so it's just...
But for me, it may not be an anti-inflammatory diet for others.
Yeah, exactly. For you, it's been the best thing ever.
It's been the best thing.
But it's just also trying to balance that, yes, that lifestyle may work for you, but there's bits and pieces you're going to have to tweak in order to fix different deficiencies. You know, so like making sure you're taking the right minerals and eating vegetables and fruits when you can, or if that works for you, or if you have allergies, finding that kind of balance as well, and making sure you're getting that holistic approach that works for you. You know, and not so much that this is what I'm going to throw, like this blank diet says, or this C diet blank says, or whatever, but realizing that this little piece of this diet works for me, really. And it becomes, it helps you form that lifestyle for you at that point.
It's always research, mm-hmm. no matter whether it's what you eat or how you live.
Mm-hmm.
We're just experimenting every day.
Yeah, and we're one giant experiment. And one thing that I think that really helped both of us is we have a friend of ours that's a nutritionist.
Yeah.
And she really educated both of us on some things to look at.
Can
and
we say hi, Nikki?
Yes.
Hi, Nikki.
And I'll put her information in the description box below. I would recommend her to anybody to work with. I love Nikki. She's been one of the best things that's helped me in my career, and it's I've implemented a lot of things I've learned from her with my athletes and into my mother. Because sometimes the conversations me and Nikki would have would be very different than what she would have, but it's on a different level of what we're discussing and implications of how we would apply it to somebody in our lives and how can we best fit them. Because sometimes it's like, okay, this is what the research says, but taking it from that research, which is very, very standard and very in a box, and you have to realize how to translate it and put it into normal life, and that's a whole another ball game too. And also a lot of people,
that's your one size does not fit all.
Yeah, exactly. And also it evolves with your life too, because also what works for you now may not work for you in a year or 2 years or 5 years
what
too.
What worked for me 30 years ago does not work for me now.
Yeah, exactly. And realizing that also what your life was like at that point, whether you've had kids or you do have kids and things, your time allotment that you have with that's going to be completely different.
It is.
And also one thing that I think I definitely wanted to touch on is the expectations that we set for ourselves and whether, you know, if we achieve this perfect sense of what we want to be rather than really focusing on the other means of progress and like how we feel, what we can do and things of that sort, and realizing that that essence should be the more perfect sense of ourselves and then rather than that perfect number or perfect size and things of that sort too.
That is how I want to address the keto diet. Mm-hmm. I quit sugar for 30 days and I lost 4 ounces.
Mm-hmm.
And then just per chance, I went on the keto diet. Mm-hmm. I was gonna do it for 30 days. And I don't know why 30 days is my number, but it is. And so I did, and I lost 10 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was all good and fine. Third day after I went on the keto diet, no back pain. So whether I had lost an ounce mm-hmm. or not, my body felt so good mm-hmm. that now I'm 5.5 months
mm-hmm.
into the keto diet because that's what works for me. My expectation, I don't even know what my expectation was. It was not to be pain-free.
Mm-hmm.
And I am.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was the deciding factor for me.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's how my life has evolved into this position that I'm in now
mm-hmm.
because I feel good.
Exactly.
And I don't care if I was a size 2. If I didn't feel good, I wouldn't be happy.
Exactly. And I think we just need to realize that we need to set our expectations around other things besides what our size is.
It is. I'm trying to be a rock star at this age, though. And so I have an expectation of how I look and my energy level.
Yeah.
And I have a great energy level.
Mm-hmm. Well, and also I think that eventually you find something that works and you can achieve that goal as well. But I think sometimes we set this unrealistic plan for how we're going to reach it and also realizing that it's going to have to change a little bit at a time as you go through to reach that new level, because if you do the same thing you've always done, you're always going to stay in the same place that you always have been or worse.
You know, an expectation that I had to let go of
mm-hmm.
is that there's no finish line.
Oh, no joke.
And so
it never ends.
Instead of thinking, okay, I'm going to do this till I get to this perfect weight,
mm-hmm.
there is no finish line.
I know.
And so I'm just happy every day to feel good. If that number on the scale goes down, fine. I don't weigh but once a month now.
Mm-hmm.
And
which is a good thing for her.
It is a good thing because I was a scale junkie.
She was a mental attachment to it, and we're working on that.
So just knowing that there isn't a finish line and that every day you've achieved a goal just by getting through that day feeling good
mm-hmm.
is a finish line for that day. It's
exactly.
not a finish line, it's an achievement.
Exactly.
And so that was a good thing for me to learn.
Exactly. And for me, it was really realizing that, so it's funny you say that. I want to cater off that a little bit. So when I competed in the bikini competition, I was almost show ready, and I had somebody come up to me and goes, "Oh man, you look fabulous. Are you gonna stop working out?" And but it occurred to me that they didn't realize that in order to stay like that, I had to keep doing that kind of activity to maintain that. So you can work toward that goal, but there's gonna have to be a give and take in order to stay where you're at or be able to do that thing. So you have to realize that that's like there's a give and take and energy process involved in that as well too.
That's why it's called maintenance.
Yeah, no joke.
You have to maintain everything. You have to maintain your ability to read.
Mm-hmm.
You have to maintain your ability to sing. And that is by continuing and practicing every day. So that's what I have found for me is maintenance, which some people call practice.
Yes.
And so
exactly.
That's an ongoing thing. It's like lifelong learning.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And when you stop learning and maintaining, you fall apart.
Yeah, because you're not doing anything to keep those pieces together or evolve with the new types of things. Because one thing I've read recently that I truly believe is we tend to have the same problems. They just evolve into a new piece of our life and how they play out. So it just may manifest itself in another problem. But here's the thing about that is you already semi-prepared for that to come in at that time because you've already practiced a solution to that at some point. It just may be modified in how you fix that problem now.
And that, you know, that's something that they say about alcoholism is that when people stop abusing alcohol and yet they start shoplifting or they start shopping, it's their addiction coming out a different hole.
Yeah, it has to manifest that. You have to put the energy into something else because what a lot of people don't realize between alcohol or text messages or tobacco or anything, that's a dopamine hit. Yeah, food's another one. That's a dopamine hit, and that's your instant response to happiness. And dopamine's your happy chemical. But here's the thing about, here's how you translate that, is you have to figure out how to direct that energy to something that's lifelong and that supports it, and that's how you get the oxytocin and serotonin in your process. Exactly. And other ways to do that is to incorporate people into your lives and also work through a process.
Yes, and exercise. I mean, Kelsey is a wonderful example of exercise. I'm a 33 year older example, and even if it's just walking, 10,000 steps a day is a lot of steps a day. Get three, get 6,000, get something.
Start where you're at.
And if it's just, okay, today every commercial, I'm gonna get up and walk around the house. Okay, that's great, that's just one step. Same way with water. I'm going to drink water before every meal today. Or, you know, baby steps add up. I do it, but it won't.
Exactly.
So I will not do that. I'm going to go on and be happy.
Exactly. And that kind of fits into something else I probably wanted to touch on, is that one size does not fit all.
That's why there's a million diets.
Exactly. And also that.
And workouts.
And sizes and activities and lifestyle choices and things that sort of could. Because your lifestyle is very different than my lifestyle, and you're my mother.
By far.
And also her diet on a daily basis is very different than mine, but what we... Okay, correct.
But we look great, don't we?
Yes. Well, one thing that I had to work with you on over the past, I think it's been about 5 years, 6 years we've had this talk, was that you can't just pick one part of a diet or lifestyle. You have to take the best pieces and mold it into your own lifestyle, because what works for one person may not work exactly the same for you as a script. Also, the other thing is, as your life evolves, what previously worked for you won't work for you now or later on, and that's
age does change things.
Exactly, or circumstances, or, you know, it changes all the time. What previously you had time for, you may not, or your priorities completely shift.
Or suddenly you have more time.
Exactly.
And you can do all kinds of things.
Exactly, so it just kind of, you have to be open to that kind of thing and just be willing to listen to yourself and see what you want and be willing to go with it. And that includes your life and your career and your family or whatever else you want to do. I think the biggest thing for me was being willing to realize that I'm valuable enough to invest in myself, because I will have a better impact in the people around me because I've taken care of myself. Because a healthy life is more than what I put into my body and what I do with my body.
It's a lot, you know. I would go as far as to say 90% of it's mental.
It is, because if you can't get over the thought pattern you have in your head and that mindset, you won't be able to put the right foods in your body or do the right thing with your body.
Go for that 10,000 steps a day.
Exactly, or whatever the case may be, because you're too busy fighting that mental aspect. And I think we need to realize that health is way broader than we limit it to be, which is just food and movement. There's the psychological aspect and the mental aspect to it, and the spiritual too, that you have to adjust. Whether you believe or you don't, but you have a belief system on whatever spectrum you are, and you have to be able to come to peace with whatever you believe in that part. Because if you're not in peace in that realm, it'll start to infect in other places, because you're having issues in this part, it's almost like you will self-sabotage into the other areas of your life as well.
Well, I would go so far, and this, I'm a big proponent of this. I know there are a lot of people out there protesting things. Mm-hmm. This is my thing. Don't protest anything. Whatever you're pro, be pro that.
Exactly.
Get off your butt.
Yeah.
And be that. Yeah. Because we can all stand around and shoot holes in somebody else's belief system. Mm-hmm. Great. Tell me why yours is so good.
Exactly.
Don't tear someone else down. Mm-hmm. Build yourself up. Mm-hmm. And this is a whole nother thing, but that taking a knee thing, nah. Stand up for whatever it is you believe in. I believe in being kind. Mm-hmm. I believe in my kids. And I think if you do something good for someone else, no matter what that is,
yeah,
you will feel better. Exactly. And I know you've made the world a better place. So protest nothing. Mm-hmm. Encourage.
Yeah, be pro whatever you are.
Be pro. Use your, I think that everybody's power should be for good. Mm-hmm. You know.
Well, I want to touch on a piece that, about that, is that in order to be pro of something, you usually had to educate yourself at some point.
Thank you. Instead of just blindly following.
And so take the time to educate yourself and
on whatever it is.
And be open to hear what somebody else says, because you may go, I never thought of that. Great example. I had been an anti-extremist kind of diet for years and years and years. And that included keto, Mediterranean, Atkins, and things. And keto works brilliantly for my mother.
Third day on keto, my back pain. I used to have to, mm-hmm. It took me 20 minutes when I'd lay down at night, mm-hmm. to find a comfortable position to sleep in. Mm-hmm. Third day,
yeah,
that went away.
Exactly.
And so, had I not had that kind of return on my diet investment, mm-hmm. I might not be on this diet. Time. And it's not a diet, it's a lifestyle.
Exactly. And that, the other thing with that is that
my biggest motivator is no pain.
Exactly. And you found out your measuring stick for progress was not what was on the scale.
Correct.
But it does help when the scale does move. So for example, what did you try before you did keto? What was that?
Hang on. Oh, well, 30 days I went on no sugar.
No sugar, and you lost what? Four ounces?
4 ounces.
Yeah, I remember that phone call.
That was probably a shoe. Who knows?
Yeah, exactly. And then you started keto. And 3 days in, you had no back pain, and that changed the progress stick completely. And then what was after 3 days?
I had committed to 30 days on that diet for a diet.
Yes.
And I lost 10 pounds in 30 mm-hmm. days. And mm-hmm. I lost the pain.
Yep.
And so the thought of, okay, that finish line, which there's not one, mm-hmm. at 30 days mm-hmm. was gone.
Exactly.
And now it's not a diet, it's a lifestyle, mm-hmm. because I'm happy.
Exactly.
I'm happy anyway. Mm-hmm. But I have no pain, which makes happiness easier.
Correct.
And I feel fabulous. Now I'm down 30 pounds.
Exactly.
Which almost doesn't feel like an accomplishment. It just happened.
Exactly.
And I'm thrilled about it, because I would have had anxiety coming to see you.
Mm-hmm,
because and I was so happy because I could wear jeans again.
Exactly. And I think the other thing I wanted to point out is that you didn't give up.
No.
You tried different things, and also you started to realize that you had to mold bits and pieces of different diets and to create the lifestyle that worked for you. And that's the big thing.
And that is what I've done here.
Yeah.
I mean, you're not going to read what I do for me in a book.
No, not at all.
I took a piece from that book, a piece from this book. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you're right. That's exactly right.
And that's why it's so important to be open to opportunities. And sometimes it's why it's important to have coaches, because it may not work for you, but you learn something from that experience, but you learned what didn't work. And sometimes that's just as valuable.
Well, having Kelsey Lane Fitness,
yeah,
which is great because I had her, so I get to keep her.
Forever.
To get me, I mean, 90 grams of protein became my goal. Which is not what the keto diet is about at all.
No, not at all.
But 90 grams of protein is what is sustainable for a woman my age to feel good, to have the energy.
And hormones, which is something that you, when you start going through the menopause state, do start to alter. And this is one way to help maintain that as well.
And feel it good.
Yeah, exactly.
And then I adjusted her 90 gram of protein. It was a suggestion, then it became an insistence. To put more than 90 grams of fat into my diet. I always want to exceed protein by fat, which takes away the hunger. But I think the protein was the key to...
That's it for...
We had to leave for coffee or whatever.
Yeah. Okay, so the camera overheated and died, but we hope you enjoyed this conversation.
We did.
With us. So if you would love us to do any more of these, we are always looking for... times to get together.
Oh, I love an audience. I'm an entertainer, like I said. So.
And you probably can hear my dad playing right now.
Yes.
And that's their music. I'll put all their stuff in.
That's below. Some of it.
Yes. So, but we love you guys. Thank you so much for joining us on Vlogmas, and we'll see you guys next time. Bye. Okay. Okay, we're actually recording.
Is it really working?
Yes, we have a red dot. We're good. So we thought we filmed this yesterday. Made it through the whole conversation. And then I get up to turn it off and realize it wasn't on.
Fortunately, we like to talk to each other, so that's good.
Exactly. So, you know, we just had a practice run. For sure. So
that was rehearsal.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, I like it.
So hi everybody, welcome back to Vlogmas, and today I have my wonderful mother, Elane, and I'll put all of her information down below for you guys to check out her and dad and their band, Wait For What.